raise your hand, 11 o'clock, both of us.
What do we?
So we don't get much of CJ at 11, so I assume you're there, you're more visible at 8:30. Anyway, but there's so much laughter. You know Allison and how well lively she is. You get Allison and CJ together, it's so much fun, and it's so happy. And you can't help but be happy when you're here, just because of those two ladies. And now we've got Stacy, I don't think she's in here yet. She's a smoky monkey too, so anyway, it's a great place to work, and that hallway is so much fun. I don't know CJ very well, so selfishly that's why I invited her to do this. Because I want to get to know her, I want to know about her past, and I want to understand what a millennial is. So I hope you're going to explain that. So.
Yikes.
Okay, CJ, you're up.
So I spoke with one of the UMW circles like a couple weeks ago, and they asked me to share my life story, and I was like, you know, anytime that you're going to create a space where I can talk about myself, that's right? Just thank you for being here and allowing me a space, a podium to talk about me and to talk about the younger generation that we call millennials, right? And what that means and looks like for our churches. And I think so many times that I'm going to talk a little bit about this, but like Connie said, she's like, I don't know what a millennial is. And I'm like, so that's a lot of pressure to talk about like an entire generation that spans over 25 years, right? And that's a big feat and a big job to take on, but I'm going to do my best. I'm up to it. Boss says I'm up to it, so I'm up to it. I hope to do it some justice and to give you just a little glimpse into my part of millennialism and my part of why that's important to me in the church and why I'm kind of stuck with it and plan to continue us thinking with that. So Connie said that she doesn't know me well, which, you know, I like to think I'm an open book, but sometimes I get called out that maybe I'm not as open of a book. In like my most like vulnerable sense, so I'm gonna try to do that for y'all today, so you get to get a glimpse into to who I am and why I do all those things. So I'm gonna start with this little story. So a couple years ago, I decided that the world needed to know what was on my brain, what was on my heart, all of my thoughts, like through any life experience that I was having, and I started a blog. As many millennials have tried and failed just as successfully as everybody else did. And so, at the top of my blog, you're kind of required, they ask you to do a little blurb to give a little highlight, a little sense of who you are, right? And so, I gave a lot of thought to this, right? And because you only have, like, so many words, and, like, there's a lot about me that I want to share with the world, and so, like, I had to be concise, right? So I'm going to read you what the top of my blog says. I am not updating my blog currently, so don't go looking for it. It hasn't been written since like 2015. But this is what the top of my blog says. I am CJ. I love Mexican food. I am passionate. I love to laugh. I love drinking wine. I so enjoy conversations over good coffee. I struggle with self-esteem issues. I love to-do lists. I want to spend my time here on earth helping people. I struggle with organized religion. Being a 20-something, which I only have like 5 more months left of, but being a 20-something is hard and it is exciting. I love Ryan Gosling. Whew, he is handsome. I am blessed beyond belief with incredible friends and incredible family. I do not like being alone. It is hard for me to like everyone that I meet. I dream about my potential future family often, and I'm a precious child of God.
Amen.
So there are some really great things and there are some really hard things that I had to like be okay with putting it out there on the internet for the world to see, right? But this is a really solid snapshot of who I am and who God has created me to be. And so that gives you just a little introduction into who CJ is. And today was advertised with my silly little cutout face, thanks Nancy, my cutout face, an advertisement. is my faith journey a millennial's tale. And on Sunday, Greg Blakey, who is a parent of a couple of my youth, some of you might know Kelly and Greg Blakey. Greg came up to me and thinks it's really funny, and he was like, my name is CJ, he's Greg. He says, so CJ, I don't think you're a millennial. And I was like, offended. I was like, of course I'm a millennial. I'm young and I'm cool and I'm hip. And I was like, technically I really am a millennial. And I had, I've looked up a lot of times like, what is a millennial? What defines you as a millennial? How do you get to be in this, like, this generation? Right? And I did a lot of research a couple years ago because I was like, not sure if I really fit into it, because I would argue, and maybe I'm being a little bit like too nice to myself, but I would argue that I don't fit some of the like negative characteristics that so many of us stick on millennials, right? So I wasn't sure if I wanted to own that generation. So I looked it up. And generations, as you know, kind of, they span between like 20 and 30 years, right? Like, so, and they're kind of wishy-washy as to like really what years define what generations. You know, we have all these titles for all the generations, and so I did a lot of research as to like all of the different magazines that define millennials and all the different posts that are about it. Like, the internet is full of ideas on what a millennial is, what years were these people born in, and who are they, what are they, all of them. So, what I've kind of found and what I'm going to agree with is that it's about from like the early 1980s to like the early 2000s, right? So I fit there, right? I'm on the older side of this millennial generation, but I'm in there. So that was my argument right back to Greg Blakey is, yes, I am a millennial, and it has taken me a few years to own that generation and to be okay with it and be excited about being a millennial in 2017. Okay? And what that means for me. So I'm really proud to say I'm a millennial today. I'll always be a millennial because I was always born in the same year. It will never change. So I'm a young person in a not young church, right? The United Methodist Church is not known for just a bunch of young people hanging around and getting excited, right? Not generally speaking. And so I'm a young person in an older church. I started working in ministry, actually getting paid to work in ministry when I was 23 years old. So for my entire adulthood, most of my entire adulthood after college has been spent being paid in ministry in the United Methodist Church. And I have been often stamped as the token young person on the staffs that I have served on. Because I still am the youngest person on our staff. Like, I don't know if it's going to change. I don't know. I would love it. Young people can come. So, I am always the token young person. And because of that, like, I sit in meetings with people, and I sit in conversations with people, and they look to me to speak for an entire generation, to speak for young people. How, CJ, can we get young people back into our church? And I'm like, whoa, great question. That I do think about often, I don't have the answer to, right? But I often get looked at for that because I'm the token young person, right? I have only ever worked in the United Methodist Churches. I've worked in three of them. It's not like I've worked in a million churches. But I've worked in three churches, all United Methodist Churches. And I'm not going to be shocked if that continues to be my path, right? To only work in United Methodist Churches. So why do I stay in an older, traditional denomination of the Christian church when it seems like all the other young people, my friends included, are fleeing to more young-friendly churches or denominations, or just fleeing from the church completely, right? So I'm gonna give you a good long story of my just upbringing and why I do stay in the United Methodist Church and why I do plan to stay in the United Methodist Church. I grew up at First United Methodist Church of Arlington, and when I started here at this church, there was a lot of parallels that I saw between this church and that church. They're similar in size, they're similar in like demographic, just similar in the kind of ministries that they have to offer and how we go about it. So to me, like the moment I started here, this place was comfortable. It was home for me because it was very similar and parallel to the church that I knew for 25 years that I was a member of that church. So I started going there when I was 2 years old. I do not remember my very first day there. But me and my sisters all got baptized at the same time. My little sister was 0 years old. She was just born. I was 2, and then my older sister. sister was 5. We all got baptized at the same time at First United Methodist Church by Dr. Don Pike, who's one of my favorite people in the whole entire world. And I very quickly, I've only ever known life involved in that church. I got involved in children's choir at a young age, so like 5 years or 4 or 5 years old, you get to join children's choir. And Jerry Gray was the choir teacher to us when I was 5, and she continues to be and will always be part of the village that raised me. And she taught me the books of the Bible to the tune of some song that I can still recite to you if you want. I'll give it to you at another time, but not on mic. But I started singing in the choir, and then as I got into Sunday school, I was just excited about what was happening, and it was thriving. This is the 90s, so it was a time when like the Methodist Church was like doing really, really quite well, right? So it was thriving. There was a ton of people around. My best friends were there. My parents' best friends were there, and we just did life together as we grew up, right? We went on campouts with my parents' Sunday school class. I invited all my church friends to my birthday parties and vice versa, and my church family was my village, right? There are people that to this day, even though I don't constantly talk to them, they are the people who raised me, right? They're a part of that village who raised me. And as I got older and got to understand more of what the church is, what the church does, why we should be involved in the church, and I'm in the youth program, and I'm like getting excited about all these things, and I want to be in leadership. And so there were a lot of opportunities that started to present themselves when I was an early teenager, right? So I get on the youth leadership board, and I'm in the youth choir, and we're just having a really great time going on all the mission trips and all of the choir tours that we had available to us, going on every retreat, doing every single thing that I could. Many times I was at the church, well, it's still accurate today, I was at the church more than I was at my own home, right? I was with these people, this village that was raising me more than I was with my own parents sometimes. And that was great for me. I loved it. I thrived in this place, right? I just was such a fan of those people. And to this day, because teenage years are so formative in making us exactly who we are, I attribute that so much to First United Methodist Church of Arlington for creating spaces for me and opportunities for me to grow in who I was, who God created me to be, I'm just really grateful for that always, continuously grateful. So I went to college, and I'm going to talk about college in a minute because that was a really interesting time for me. So like, I'll talk about college. So I went to college, came back from college, went to that church for a couple of years, worked at that church for a couple of years, and now I'm no longer a member there. It was like a really, really tough thing for me to pull my membership from that church and become a member up here in the North Texas Conference. So I'm grateful for this upbringing that I had, right? These people who place an importance of who God is, place an importance of what the United Methodist Church is, even though I didn't recognize that along the way. Hindsight teaches me a lot, right, as I look back on it. But along the way, I was learning a lot about what's important in the United Methodist Church and why I need to be a part of it. So the United Methodist Church, at 18 years old, was all I knew. I had been to a couple of friends' churches, my Girl Scout friends' churches, a couple of times. Was not my cup of tea. But basically, generally speaking, the United Methodist Church is all I ever knew. I knew women in ministry my whole life. Like, we always had associate women pastors, always. So this is all I ever knew. So when I went to college, I went to a very small, conservative Baptist college. It's called Wausau Baptist University in Arkadelphia, Arkansas. Some of you might know that. It's a beautiful, beautiful campus, and I love, love, love that place. And so I went there because of their music school. I did not go there because they were Baptist. I went there because of their music school, really, really fantastic music school. I knew that I wanted to be a high school choir director. Cool. Yeah. I liked all those noises. That was good. That was funny. So I went to be a high school choir director. Little did I know that at 18 years old, starting at Wausau Baptist University was the beginning of some of the most challenging times in terms of what I believe and why I believe it. So within the first week of my time at Ouachita Baptist University, I had a really, really tough conversation with a guy who actually became one of my really good friends as we got to know each other better. And it was one of the first conversations of my life that I had ever had that I disagreed with. Excuse me. I'm gonna be the victim here. That someone disagreed with me about what the Bible said about homosexuality. And that was tough for me. So I wasn't brought up saying like homosexuality is right or wrong or this Bible says this or this. Like, it wasn't really a topic of conversation as it is today when I was a teenager, right? But something in me tells me like, this is what I believe. This is where I firmly stand with this. And this person, his name was Matt, stood across. It wasn't this Matt. We didn't go to college together. his name was Matt. We sat across the table from each other in the cafeteria, and we argued. Like, it got heated. And this was like, I'm telling you, in the first 72 hours of me being at Ouachita Baptist University. this person was disagreeing with me about what the Bible says about a big social issue. This was just the beginning. I didn't know it, but this was just the beginning for me. It was the beginning of a long line of conversations, of sermons, of chapel talks, of Christian Focus Week topics that I would struggle with, that I would leave those places, those times, and I would have to chew on something, whether they were big somethings or small somethings, because it was not in line with how I was raised. I wrote notes because I'm a rambler. You probably know this about me. But I wrote notes, so here we go. So by Christmas time of my freshman year, Christmas of 2006, I was ready to throw in the towel. I had too many times where I was like super uncomfortable, and I was like, why would I put myself in a place where everybody would disagree with me? And I was super ready to be done with that school. I did not like being surrounded by people that did not agree with me. I mean, like, can I get an amen, right? We all want to be surrounded by people who believe the same things as us because it's comfortable for us, right? We don't have to have hard conversations, controversial conversations, and I begged, I'm telling you, like, on my hands and knees, begged my parents to not make me go back. Y'all are so fun. I love how, like, y'all are just, like, totally bouncing. I'm loving it. Okay, so, I begged my parents not make me go back after the holidays. But they made me go back because they're awful and they're mean and they're the worst. But hindsight shows me, remember, hindsight gives us a lot of great knowledge, right? So hindsight shows me that was not my parents forcing me back, but that was God forcing me back into an uncomfortable situation because he had something that he had to teach me. He had a lot, there was a lot of growth that CJ, 18-year-old CJ, had to learn, right? So I went back to college. 2 weeks into my spring semester of freshman year, I met who is now my best friend. Her name is Amanda Bryson. She was here with me a couple weeks ago, and I'm going to Arkansas this weekend to see her. And Amanda Bryson's dad is a Southern Baptist minister in Hot Springs, Arkansas. So Amanda was raised Southern Baptist. Oh boy, I was raised United Methodist. She was raised Southern Baptist in the Bible Belt in Arkansas. And so I found my best friend. And I knew from like the minute that I met her that she was my best friend. And so obviously, like, there was a continuous theme in college of me finding people that I was gonna have like some really hard conversations with. But it became easier for me because I started to meet people. My best friend is the biggest and best example. Meet people who were still gonna love me, who were still gonna respect me, and vice versa. That I was still going to love and I was still going to respect, regardless of the theological and fundamental differences that we might have about who God is and what the Bible says about all that, right? And all of the things that we're having to do. And so, hindsight is like a theme here. Because as I look back on these times, in the moment I didn't realize it, but as I look back on it, as we all do, on these life experiences, I look back on it and I realize God was just really prepping me and really preparing my heart for what the world looks like, right? to be around people who don't agree with you, but that you can still sit at a table with and still love them at the end of the day because you have one commonality with them, and that is Jesus. And that is that we are created by one God, one true God, who is awesome and we all love. And all of that other silly little, excuse me, crap doesn't really matter. Right? I'm getting a little preachy. hindsight. I sit here at 29 years old and I look back at my college experience and I thank God for giving me those times. Woo! Those really difficult times where I had to learn how to love because of who Jesus is. So I'm thankful for that. I constantly, like you, if you ever sit down and have a conversation with me about anything that's difficult for me, I'm just like constantly grateful for Jesus, and I'm constantly grateful for maturity, right? And that is what happened to me in college. Not that I like figured it all out and I've got all the maturity now, but it was a big growing experience for me to be in a place in a sea of Southern Baptist conservatives where I just did not fit in. But I found friends, I found lifelong friends, that I love. So I left college with a pretty strong desire to continue being in the United Methodist Church because in college, after all those conversations and within all of those conversations, it was only challenging me to become more deeply rooted in what in the seeds that were sown in me in my upbringing. That village that I talked about, they were sowing some seeds. And that started really growing when I was in college because of the challenge, right? And so I was like, oh, I love United Methodism. And I like became this like total United Methodist dork. And I came back super ready. I came back super ready to be in the United Methodist Church, to be involved, to be deeply rooted in the United Methodist Church in some way. But at this time, I still wanted to be a high school choir director. So let's remember that small little detail. So I did not get a job as a teacher, obviously, because you see me sitting here today. I never got a job as a teacher. I was obviously certified in Arkansas already when I graduated, and I became certified here in Texas. And jobs were not opening up for me, and it was frustrating, right? I was 22 years old, and I needed a job. I needed to get out of my parents' house, right? Like, that happened. And it wasn't opening up for me, and I was questioning, like, why did I just go and spend $100,000 on an education, and nothing has opened up for me, right? Some big questions. And so I got a job as a, I feel like I'll skip some stuff, but I don't really care, because this is good. I got a job as a preschool teacher, teaching four-year-olds, guys. At a United Methodist church in Dallas, Greenland Hills United Methodist, and it's like off Mockingbird down there, it's a cool area. And I was teaching preschool there. I was the very first preschool teacher that they hired for this brand new program in 2011. And I taught there for a short 7 months, and I really, really very quickly realized that was not where I needed to be. And I should not need to be teaching four-year-olds because God did not grant me that patience. And so the church that I grew up in, First United Methodist Church, Arlington, I started going back to when I graduated from college because I was back from my parents and I loved that place. And so I was there. And our children's minister, she had said, hey, we're trying to hire somebody because she had gotten ordained. And so they're trying to get somebody to fill in her position. And she wanted me. And I needed to be out of where I was. And I said, okay, check, let's start this job. And so I started my job as a children's minister at First United Methodist Church of Arlington, the church that I grew up in. And I loved it because I knew all the people. I already had a great relationship with these people. And I just felt like things were really thriving, right? And then some more challenges came ahead, and the church that I grew up in became a really, really tough place for me to be. Because if you get on staff at the place, that's something I learned, if you get on staff at the place that the village that raised you, you get to know some of the people who raised you in like a not so good light sometimes in church leadership. And so I had some like really hurtful time at First Arlington. I still love that place dearly, but I had some hurtful time at First Arlington getting to know an unfortunate side of some people that had raised me, right? And I was praying to God, like, what do I do with this? This is the place that I love, and I just don't know that this is the place that I need to be anymore. And so what does that mean for me, right? Like, choir director didn't work out for me. Children's ministry at First Arlington wasn't working out for me. And I'm like, ooh, what am I going to do? You know, where's my direction? And I had been volunteering and helping out the youth program at First Arlington. And I loved it. Me and the youth director, his name was Nick, we worked really well together. We just jived really well together. And we leaned on each other a lot to, like, create stuff for youth ministry. And I was realizing that I was actually putting a lot more energy and heart and passion into what I was volunteering as a youth person, as a youth counselor, than I was in my own actual job that they were paying me for. And so I was like, I think I need to go find a youth ministry job. This is my next step. Like, this is where I need to be headed. This is where God's guiding me. And so I started my job, got a job at First Farmersville up here east of McKinney, and had to leave the church that was my home. Right? And so I went to Farmersville never thinking I would ever find a church family ever again that was like First Arlington. And First Farmersville, like, showed up as my family. They showed up big time. And they nurtured me. They took me in as one of their own, because that's what country churches do, and I love that about it. And they took me in. Like, families were taking me in for dinner with their family, and I became quickly a part of the family of First Methodist Church of Farmersville.